First, I am basing my argument on the simple meaning of overlapping consensus. Starting from this level, I would then argue that overlapping consensus is a kind of compromise among different and maybe conflicting but reasonably comprehensive doctrine, in the present case, Brahmanical Hinduism and Neo-Buddhism. In my scheme of understanding, I find reasonable persons from the political organizations taking lead in reaching consensus that could be seen as overlapping. Those who are taking lead in producing the consensus seems to be using the space that they have acquired through sharing power so as to occupy the public places using religious symbols. Common Dalits and poor Hindus then have a chance to become reasonable person only through an indirect participation in the production of overlapping consciousness. Let us think about the slogans, "A Hathi Nahi Ganesh Hai, Brahma Vishnu Mahesh Hai." I mean, you produce this consensus by genetically modifying the symbols from Hathi into Ganesh. Hathi is a RPA, Republican Ambedkar symbol, but which is modified into Ganesha. Ganesha belongs to the culture of Brahmanical Hinduism. So that is the modification, which is accepted by both Dalit and the non-Dalit, and that is the UP case. Similarly, the BJP, through its Samrasta Manch, Samrasta Manch was the organization which was started in 1991 at the time of the Ambedkar centenary. Similarly, the BJP, through its Samrasta Manch, carries the image of Ambedkar almost on its head. While RSS puts Ambedkar's symbols and portrait into its shakhas very, very prominently, and you have to say namaskar to Ambedkar before you offer any prayer. So that is how the pratima of Ambedkar, the image of Ambedkar right on the head, but the pratibha, that is the genius Ambedkar, right under the feet. The overlapping consensus is vacuous because it does not substantially change the existential condition of those, for example, Dalits and the non-Dalit poor, supporters on whose behalf the consensus is reached. How far consensus at the political level converts itself into a social consensus at the ground level. If it is not translated or transformed at the ground level, concrete level, not ameliorating the condition of people at the ground level, then it might remain to be vacuous, a rhetorical option. How far the proponents of Brahmanical Hinduism would adopt Neo-Buddhism as an egalitarian alternative to hierarchical Brahmanism? That's the litmus test at the ground level. It is needless to mention here, Ambedkar's Neo-Buddhism and Brahmanical Hinduism are considered as comprehensive doctrine which are historically incommensurate. Neo-Buddhism, not other forms of Buddhism, Neo-Buddhism. Let us understand why both of these are incommensurable. According to Ambedkar, Brahmanical Hinduism is based on the ascending sense of reverence for the top of the tallest bound and descending sense of deference for the lower caste. Neo-Buddhism, on the other hand, seeks to radically even out this hierarchical sense of reference. Put differently, it advocates mutual sense of reference. That's the egalitarian principle. It actually suggests withering down of every bit of oversized ego embodied in Bhudeva. Bhudeva means God on earth. So that's the characterization of Brahmins on Bhudeva in India. Neo-Buddhism is an ethical investment in elevating human stature over the hierarchical social status that singularly defines Brahmanical Hinduism. This conflicting relationship between the two positions has been modified into compromise through the nationalist mediation. That's the new point, new phenomenon happening. Dalits and the upper caste are finding nationalism as the common mediating point to produce this consensus. In the recent times, the representatives of Brahmanical Hinduism and Neo-Buddhists have reached some compromise, choose a religious place for providing necessary context for such agreement. of late representatives from neo Buddhist chose Diksha Bhumi to enact nationalism. What do I mean by this? They now started singing Jana Gana Mana collectively. Lots of people sing that. It was not the case during Ambedkar. And in the presence of the RSS chief, sometimes chief, sometimes BJP leader. Last time it was the ex-BJP president sitting there. Earlier, people used to take serious objection to religious people shaking hands with neo-Buddhist. And this opposition was politically translated into not voting for BJP, for Jan Sangha BJP and Shiv Sena. So this kind of mediation through religious places, it has two serious implications. It denies historicity to Dalit critique of nationalism. It's not that Dalits are really supporting nationalism all through. They have also a critical angle to it. On the other hand, it also assigns discursive meaning to nationalism, where nationalism can become available to different forces for intersecting purposes.